lecture 11 is what this is, and it's up. I just edited it, so if you have printed this before by chance, there's a few small changes on it. Also under this area, where we're going right now, and we'll continue to do the rest of the semester is, what are some of the big issues with industrial agriculture? Well, rampant, crazy pesticide use, indiscriminate overuse is a huge problem. Okay? It works for agriculture because it's what gave us the kind of production that, one of the things it gave us, these very large increases in production over the last 50 years. But it's kind of running out, and it's running out, that window is running out for several different reasons. One of the things is the pests are becoming resistant to this stuff, right? You guys all know how if you take antibiotics for too long, certain bacteria will actually start becoming resistant. So the same thing with these, right? So when you use these herbicides, and especially the pesticides start becoming resistant. So then we have to start adjusting what kind of pesticides can be used. Second reason that pesticides aren't even very practical, the way they're being used right now in agriculture, is the government keeps on changing which ones are allowed. Okay? So DDT is an old example of this, but DDT was a pesticide used for mosquitoes and for other things, and we all know that DDT, for example, one of its effects, other than effects on humans, was to make the eggs of birds very fragile. So a brown pelican, which is one of the birds that was really impacted by these, one of my favorite birds, if you've been to the beach, my favorite thing is to watch those guys, like four or five of them in the, better than the flying blue angels or whatever, just flying along those waves. And the wingtips, because I'm a kind of wannabe surfer, so the wingtips are literally this far away from the wave, right? The inside guy or girl, and it's like, wow, and they come right in front of you. And then that's a good excuse that I don't have to catch that wave, it's too big because I was paying attention. Anyway, but yes.
I have a mildly off-topic question.
Yes, please.
A friend at AAE told me that you once saw a black rhino.
I have seen a black rhino, and I have been charged by a black rhino. How about that?
Charged?
Yes.
What did you do that led to getting charged?
Well, that's actually not too far off topic. So well done as pulling the instructor off topic. I know you guys are very good at that. But it does apply to this and sustain. I was working, one of the ways that, of course, the way I was raised in Africa made me very interested in environment. And now I'm obviously environment and sustainability. But when I was in college, I went and I have an animal science, my first degree is an animal science degree from University of Natal, which is one of our big universities in my home province, which is KwaZulu-Natal. So I got my degree there. When I was there, the Natal Parks Board, the Parks Board by area, came and they recruited students to go and do student projects. So it's one of the things, if you ever come to BBC, you'll be involved in. We have students do actual research projects now. We're starting a new wave of them right now. But they recruited us, and we were sent off, well, we went to one of the best national parks in South Africa, in KwaZulu-Natal. It's called Umkhonolozi. And we went there, and the research project was, they used to count the animals, right? Big thing in management conservation now is man's got in the middle of it, so now we've taken away the range of these animals. They've been put within, in this case, not within fences, but in certain areas, and people live around them, right? So now we have to assess how many animals are there, because now we're actually going to have to manage them. You know? And Americans really struggle with this, but we don't. So for example, one of the main animals we needed to know the population of was the impala, right? Antelope, about this big, really gorgeous ones, the ones that jump over the road, they're fantastic animals. But they do really well. And so their population was overpopulated, which would cause overgrazing and death of the impala themselves. what they did, the Parks Board did, they said instead of counting these by helicopter, which was super invasive, we're counting all the animals, we're going to run a transect. We're going to cut a line through the bush to count these animals. 10 kilometers wide. And we're going to pick our game guards, which were mostly Sulu guys, and we're going to put them with an unsuspecting student. That's how we always do with students, right? We get student research and give them the really cool jobs, but probably the hard jobs, right? So I hooked up with my guy, and the first morning we headed out, and I speak Zulu, so he started telling me, you know, Numza, which is, I shouldn't expect that high of respect. These people are very, very respectful people. He says, Numza, I don't understand why the Mlungu, which is the white man, is so stupid. I'm like, well, okay. All right. But he doesn't say it quite like that. He says it much nicer. Okay. So what seems to be the problem? Well, he says, everyone knows that if you're going to walk through the savannah, right? So what are we talking about? Grasslands, gorgeous, with animals everywhere, and then there's clumps of acacia, thorn trees, right? And the thorn trees are what give most of that area. Grasslands are very productive. I think we've learned about that already, right? Some of the stuff you guys have watched. But these thorn trees are even more productive because they're a legume, like alfalfa, and they produce a lot of protein. And black rhino is a browser, an extremely grumpy browser. Probably the most grumpy, aggressive of all African animals, apart from the hippo. And so very aggressive, and he's also very reclusive, and he stays in these little pockets of bush. So some of the pockets of bush might only be as big as this classroom. Others are quite a bit bigger, maybe an acre, and we had to cut through them. So the first one we got to, this guy who's not a chicken by any means, this is his work, right? And he would shoot the poachers and all sorts of things. He literally starts to basically crawl through the bush. I mean, everyone else got back like at noon. We got back right before dark, right? Because we went so slowly. Because he was like, if I have to do this, I'm not going to get myself killed by the black rhino. So it went on, and other groups got charged. One of the white rangers said he's not doing it anymore. But of course, we didn't have any choice because he's a black guy and I'm a student, so we don't have any real power, right? And so we keep going, and about a week into it, we're into right in the middle of one of these bushes, and in its clumps of bush, and what I remember is the forest just like explodes. You know, there's just the trees are coming down, and so you're taught, hey, okay, we can do this. You look for some likely thorn bush tree, and you climb. Well, they have thorns, every one of them, but that long, all the way down the trunk, mostly. Right? So I grabbed one that was probably as thick as my finger because I was in such a hurry, right? And I start climbing this thing. I hit maybe in the 3 seconds or 4 seconds, I probably get about this high, right? And which would have done me no good, probably made me a better target. But they are very, they have excellent hearing. They don't have a very good, they have a decent sense of smell. They're almost blind. They have very poor eyesight, which makes them, unfortunately now, they're being poached worse than anything, especially even in that area. And it turned out the black rhino actually charged across the front of us. So that's my black rhino sighting and charging story. Right? So should we move on now? Is that super impressive?
That was really impressive. I have no idea. That's black rhino is like inside bushes. And then
inside a little mini forest, yeah. Okay. Yeah, and I exploded up the tree. Okay, so what is integrated pest management? We are trying to come up with a solution because spraying pesticides from planes on the people that are around and all the other things that are around, like we've talked about bees, right? So the new class that they're using called nicotinamides, they're nicotine-based things, are very destructive to bees. So one of the causes, is anybody doing colony collapse disorders? Look for I'm probably not saying it correctly, but nicotinamide, something like that. They're nicotine-based pesticide. and look at the linkages that they have been able to find between them and colony collapse disorder in bees.
Oh, those mites.
There's lots of reasons that they've proposed. Mites is the most proper. The varroa mite is probably the main concern, but they like I mentioned when we talked about this, there's several different theories and several different reasons. Okay? Right? It's an IPM now is just like we're talking about sustainability, we're gonna now work with the ecosystem. We're not gonna come charging in over and above this ecosystem. We're gonna work with the ecosystem, you know, just as we do natural cycling and working with the sun as a basic sustainability principle. We're now gonna mimic the ecosystem as much as possible to make pest control happen. Because too many pests, we don't have food. So that's a basic thing. We do need to do something. Okay. All right. Okay. So, what is integrated pest management? Well, look at the word integrated pest management. So it's a reliance of a combination of techniques. Again, one more time, not just pesticides. Okay. So one would be biological control. Do you guys know the story of the hare and the turtle, tortoise? Okay, well that's not the one I'm talking about. Do you know the story of the sorry. Do you know the story of the ladybug